So, you did have some homework you were supposed to grab. No one? No one? Anyone? All right.
You did? Okay.
All right, what, tell me one thing that actually jumped out at you then.
That jumped out at me?
Mm-hmm.
I'm finding out that U.S. citizens, no matter where they reside, they have an obligation to pay tax.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so all those people who ran to Miami, that baby. So their child could be U.S. citizen to get free college education.
Yeah, that jumped out at me.
Yeah. Tax avoidance is not illegal. Okay.
Exactly.
Tax evasion is. Okay.
But don't you? Because I know someone is a U.S. citizen, but because they're not living over there, they didn't have to pay the taxes.
That's what they tell you. Nice. So.
Well, how does it go? Because she said she was exempt or something like that.
You have to pay tax on your worldwide income. Now there might be specific rules. Uh-huh. That she may be able to claim exemptions under. Let's say, for example, maybe there's a rule that says she has no U.S. sourced income.
Okay. Good morning.
Right. Now, maybe, I don't know, I'm not a tax planner for someone in that particular scenario. You know, college students supposed to pay taxes, you know that? Yeah. In the U.S. Yeah, I used to do that for college students. You have to pay taxes. It might be very little, but you should still fill out the form. I think it was a 1048 or something like that. You used to get a lot of exemptions, but particularly if you earn money on campus and stuff, and then they had limits on what you can earn. Like when I was there, you only can earn up to $2,000 a year. Yeah. All right. Okay, you're at 4. They keep asking this question, what is money laundering? Blah, blah, blah. What they really want to say is tax evasion is, by the way, what's the difference between avoidance and evasion? Anybody?
One is legal, not us.
Think in terms of what? But what is avoidance? Or what is evasion? I guess it's like, let me pick on somebody. What's your name again? Don't make me look at it, man. Ashley? Right. So it's like Ashley see Takari at the Greek festival, right? So she sees Takari twice. So what she do?
She
avoid
him.
Right? She avoid him. Right? She didn't leave the festival. Right. But if she saw the carrier at the festival and she never even entered and she just go right back to Bay Street, that's what?
Evasion.
She's scooching and ducking, you know. She just, you know, so with regard to the tax, and they'll tell you this in the notes somewhere, if you structure your affairs appropriately and legally to reduce your tax burden, that is avoidance. Now, if you fail to pay your taxes that are due, that is evasion. All right? And I don't know that they mentioned it in here, but there's a... My attorneys in the front there could correct me if I'm wrong. Because you might believe I'm a Bush attorney. You know, I got Bush mechanics. Sometimes they be better than the real mechanic, you know. For certain things. All right. So I'm the Bush attorney, right? So I think they have a case in The Hague where this was settled that you could avoid taxes. All right. So that's like the people in the Bahamas, right? You all know who you all are, like people from Grand Bahama, right? There are people on New Providence who bring stuff through the port because it's duty-free, right? And then they put it on the boat and they bring it to the Bahamas, to Nassau, and they pay no duty. Is that avoidance or evasion?
Evasion.
Really? You structured your transaction.
Avoidance.
You structured your transaction to minimize your avoidance. To your family there, they bring.
Isn't this a distinction without a difference, just like the tax thing? Because they said that it's a gray area, so even the textbook itself doesn't even know what
right.
The real
meaning,
is.
Meaning, once you get caught and we adjudicate it, right? We can determine what it is then. So, you ain't think the customs people know people do that?
Yes. They
see, now, tax evasion would be if you bring in your container and you give the custom guy a slow 100 just to hurry up or not even just open the door and close it back. Now, that's evasion, in my view. Or, you know, when you come through, maybe you don't know this, but under the old system, this is my assumption. Please do not. Under the old system, the custom officers used to go with voice on your list. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Uh-huh. So what you do is you put all the stuff that low duty voice. Okay? Or no duty. Yeah. No. So that's how you struck. Yeah, they used to do that. Like the coffee, you know, duty and coffee, you know that. Baby clothes, you know, duty or baby clothes. You know? Because what they could do, they could calculate that out, boom, they say, oh, and the last thing they see, that's 35%, 35%. Then it might have been 25%. So you have to structure your form appropriately. Or you could really irritate them and just put it on three or four different forms. And then they can take one, and you choose which one. And don't be so eager with your passport. You know, you got to be eager with your passport. Take an exemption. Yeah, no, you hold that.
Yeah.
And you play crazy.
Yeah.
I don't have no more exemption. What? What you mean, any more exemption?
All the time.
And then, and the best of all.
And you always get a good done?
Best of all.
How you mean?
If it's me, right?
I always go to the man.
You let me go to the female.
I always go to the man.
Don't mind that I'm there with my wife. I could be talking to a female. We can smile, we have jokes.
I just go to the man, you start a nice.
Is that avoidance or evasion?
That's avoidance.
Exactly.
They exercise
their prerogative. Maybe that's within their remit. To decide if they're gonna charge me or not.
Exactly. I put the information there. You just ain't
exactly.
Read it properly.
And the best gimmick of all, you find yourself a politically known person or member of parliament, you go right behind them. And you walk right through. You walk right through. And the time for that happens when you know you gotta pay $300, $500, $600 in duty. And you get walked through, you just be like, boy, what a blessing.
Look at God.
So what you call that?
Huh? Blessing. Blessing. No, that's blessing.
That's
see, if you go there and you see, all get me sidetracked. You go there and you carry on bad and you, like you and me, and you acting like you miserable because I talking with the customs officer. She opening all them bags. She putting her gloves on and she holding everything up. So be nice, you know. Don't even try that ownership thing which y'all just do. Come put your hand around me. Don't try that. You wait till we get outside and you do that. Anyhow. The
porter takes the tip back.
That one too. That one too. Anyhow. Alright, so we know the difference between evasion and avoidance. Alright. Then they talk about in not too distant past, risk of prosecution was negligible. So basically what they're saying was jurisdiction like the Bahamas, what they call secrecy jurisdiction, blah, 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 which was not really true. But because nobody was checking like that, people used to do all manner of things. That is true. Okay, the rest of that is significantly higher right now. If you are assisting persons to avoid tax or even evade, because once avoidance there, you kind of draw attention to yourself, they may look at it, i.e. avoidance could be a very complex structure that you could have in place for avoidance. So that within itself is a red flag, the fact that you're trying to avoid tax, or you, it could be down to one to evasion. What that mean for compliance professionals? That mean for you guys who may encounter that? Morning. You will find that all of us have a no-nonsense poison in our family, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And what do you do with that poison?
Avoid
them.
Yeah.
You avoid them. Because you don't want them to tell you. Now you know you shouldn't do that. You know that's wrong. Right? It's the same thing. Compliance officers are avoidance officers. People will avoid you. Alright? So they will not tell you all the information. Now, this is a copyright term that I developed because of this. It was a Swiss fine, not Credit Suisse, but it was a Swiss fine. You can't say that word. Alright, it's a Swiss fine, and what you used to have, what I used to experience, is progressive revelation. Alright, that's a good one.
I'm telling you.
Progressive revelation. So, let me give you an example of progressive revelation.
You worked with the Swiss bank or
banked
with the Swiss bank?
No, I worked with the Swiss bank. Worked with. And the fella came to me, right, the compliance role, give me all the information I need to sign up for and approve the account. Well, make a recommendation for approval, but they know I really was approving it, but I call it a recommendation for approval. Because the rest is the management on, right? So I look at it, so I went to my boss. I say, you get that gut feeling?
Mm-hmm.
This is a brothel. Right. So she tell me, okay. So I was declining it. Boom. Because the policy was they ain't doing no business with no brothel.
Mm-hmm.
Some banks do, because you know it's legal in some places. It's a cash cow. So, I mean, I heard it's a cash cow. So anyway. So the relationship manager came back to me like 10 minutes later. Smith, okay, let me be honest. This really a brothel? He said, I know. He knows the policy. So why are you going to bring me that? Right. So that's what I call progressive revelation. So sometimes you may just have to, you know, like how when you go through the U.S., customs and they random screen.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you gotta make random decisions and decline that one. And that you ain't gonna accept it. You just decline the one to test see what can happen. You may have to make random decisions, particularly if the relationship officer does not present him or herself as a honest, transparent, reliable person. You may have to test the water with that one every now and then. Okay? So progressive revelation. I think they still use that term in the entity now. Okay, now. FATCA, U.S. Foreign Account Tax Compliance. Hey, everybody familiar with FATCA?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
Who say uh-huh? Okay. Tell me one significant thing about FATCA.
Thanks to U.S. or non-U.S. residents, you have the W-N or the W-9 form.
Mm-hmm.
One applies to U.S. citizen and one applies to non-U.S.
Okay. That's true. Partially. Anybody have any clarification? What about that wonderful word they call DSHA? Anybody with non-D shit? Don't even turn the D shit.
There's indicators to identify Americans.
Right. So it's the same screening you, I mean, you may use, right? Indicia, player, straight up, nice Christian fella. No, for real. And, you know, say an indicia. So for example, okay, have a job. Okay. Shoes clean. Well groomed. That's indicia. They're indicators, right? So same thing in the FATCA thing. Do you have a U.S. address? Do you have U.S. derived income? Do you have a U.S. passport? You see, that kind of stuff. Indicia could also be children. Do you have children in the U.S.? Because all of that may attract a tax burden or responsibility. Okay, so beyond being a U.S. citizen, which a lot of entities say U.S. passport, yes or no, and they stop right there. No, that's not a FATCA check. So you have to look for U.S. indicia on FATCA to determine if there's a tax obligation. So then you go to the W-8 or W-9, which they change from time to time. Okay, and then they have an W-8 supplement. And a supplement for companies. Yeah. They get very complicated. Mm-hmm. That's very good. Very good. Because that means I get more weight. Yeah, I got to go read the form, find if anything new, and then I got to charge you for that. More weight. That's good. That's like, they do that with the cars. You know, they bring out the car, then they used to have the car with the, what you used to call it? What the thing the gases go through?
Funny.
No, in the car, an engine. And then they make it without it. Or a gas pump. Yeah. It's up the gas pump. But the gas is going in there and then floating it and stuff. They don't do that no more. Fuel injected and stuff like that. So same thing. And then the mechanics have to be more educated. Alright, so now see y'all remember that, right? Alright. Page 10. Oh, we gotta speed up. Tax payable and conflict rules that determine where taxes are paid.
Page 10.
Alright, so what they really say in there, for those who read, you would be familiar with it. For those who didn't, well, you gotta read it. What they really saying is there are certain things to determine where taxes are paid, like income tax, holding tax, capital gain tax, blah blah blah, which we have none of in this jurisdiction. Other than VAT. And tariff and excise tax. We don't have a social security tax, but we have NIB. All right. So they tell you these different kinds of taxes. You read it on your own. Blah blah blah. Right. So sales and value added is VAT. You know what that is. The excise tax would be the customs tax that would be evaded by going to grandmama. All right. Page. Oh, yeah, page 112 and so on, they tell you what the tax in different countries, blah, blah, blah. Then go over to 2.2. Page 113, introduction to conflict of revenue laws. So what you need to know, there are conflict of revenue laws. Conflict of revenue laws, okay. So, money on compliance officer, blah, 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 does not arguably need to know the complexities of internal tax laws determined by different people. You ain't got to know these laws everywhere else. Okay? That's all they say. Territorial reach. Now, you need to be aware of the territorial reach. Like, for example, the territorial reach of the U.S. Okay? FATCA. That has territorial reach. That's why people was pulling all the hell with regard to FATCA, doing a FATCA review and all that kind of stuff. Territorial reach. As a matter of fact, are you aware that the FATCA rules and so on put tremendous responsibility on you?
Yes.
Make sure you are not registered poison, because you know you have to register with the IRS and stuff. Yeah. I have some clients, you all need to register, don't you? I like prior to Trump, I used to like traveling to the U.S. So I won't get stopped with no seal indictment. And they hold me, you know. No. So be careful. Be informed. Don't let people push you to just do things. Okay? If your institution pushing you to do that, you need to make sure you get the right indemnity. You know who your lawyer is. But they ain't gonna leave you hanging. No, for real, because they'll leave you hanging. They can mitigate the institutional risk. I know someone still locked up in Colombia. Then they had that Casablanca sting. That's before many. That's what, 22 years ago. Still locked up. And my colleagues were afraid to travel to the U.S. But they didn't listen to me. So, anyhow. So, yeah. I just said that you all need to understand the extraterritorial thing. So, FATCA, you also have something that's commonly referred to as GATCA, right? What is GATCA? What they really saying is that's the European, that could be the European version of FATCA. Oh. Right. And it's coming already because you have that called what? CRS, Common Reporting Standard. So, everybody was up in, but CRS? So you had the U.S. people that we used to be worried about, and then we say we ain't taking on no U.S. clients because of FATCA and because they're litigious. Now you get the European people like the French and all of them, and people having problems with them. So what they doing? They're trying to find all kind of FATCA or CRS compliant products. Right? You know what a compliant product is? In their minds, the one that they ain't concerned about. So we could put everything in this kind of product or that have limited exposure. Trust don't necessarily have limited exposure anymore, but insurance products might. Okay? And we creative people, you know. That's what makes us good bankers. We know about shipwrecking, rum running, all that kind of stuff. That's not DNA. That was the industry. So I know that, right? Shipwrecking was the industry. Yes, I need to listen to them songs, man. Church out. You want to know about that?
Yeah.
Okay. When the shipwrecked preacher and the service and be good. Anyhow. So, 114. 114. To me, this is perhaps, this was perhaps the most interesting part of the unit. Okay? The jurisdiction authority to impose taxation. A state can only impose tax when substantial connecting factors are established. Indicia? Okay. Residence, a source of income, blah, blah, blah. Now, residence. Most states impose tax where there's a substantial connection that links the state and the taxpayer. So, for example, there's this rule. I see they have 183, but I thought it was 184. You have 184 days. To my recollection, or according to them, 183 in the U.S., you're deemed resident.
Yeah.
So all y'all who like to travel 6 times a year to the U.S. for 2 weeks at a time, do the calculation, you may have to pay tax. You can't hang that flag, ice beam, man. You may have to pay U.S. tax. You know, some people who go shopping for people all the time, every week they off the island.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, firstly, a person who has the privilege of residing in a particular country and enjoying its infrastructure. So when you live here and you enjoy an infrastructure, blah, 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 all the roads, lights, everything else, hospital, da, 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 you should be paying.
Benefits, the country, the state.
Yeah. So my voice of opinion, that's why I shouldn't be paying no property tax. I live here. I'm a citizen. That shouldn't be for me. I pay my other tax. That's for the people who are living here. Who live in here? Wondering my road, my bad roads, my lights, traffic lights, all that. They should be paying. They should pay more than me, personally. Don't run me down, and you get millions of dollars out there. You can't even send the people the tax bill properly. Anyhow, I could fix that. But anyway, yeah. Okay, first, Firstly, a person who has the privilege of residing in the infrastructure. Secondly, it is only fair and equitable that all taxpayers who reside in the country should be subject to
the same laws.
Yeah. You know. So I think that's what's happening
that's
now.
Only fair.
Anyhow. Only 400,000 of us, man. We shouldn't have that burden. We shouldn't be trying to collect all the tax. I mean, I read Simon Dance in the paper about how they're aggressively doing this, coming to your house. But why don't you fly to England and deliver some of them tax bill there? You taxing me, 400,000 people. You know, that's right. Let's put income tax in place and corporate tax. Then that's better for me. They need to play Monopoly more often, you know, and then they'll understand how this thing works. Anyway, residents of individuals. You want to play Monopoly? Anybody? Oh, I always win. Call you soon. Monopoly getting, like they say, gooder and gooder now. Yeah. All right, residency of individuals. Individual taxpayer may have a personal connection to a particular state by reason of residence, domicile, citizenship, blah, 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 blah. Okay? Then they go on, domicile nationality on 115. Domicile, a person is domiciled in the place where he or she has a settled home. Now that could be a problem. Because plenty of people get home like in Albuquerque, Long Island, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Then they get home in France and everything. Yeah. Even up Bahamas with homes all over the place, you know. You have some wealthy Bahamians. Mm-hmm. Wonder where they resident. So, I don't know how you determine that. Size of home, the value of the home, like which one makes you, you know, how do you determine which home determines your domicile? Is it where you live, in terms of where you reside, like when you're in them relationship and you get a divorce, and the judge won't know where your clothes is and stuff like that. When I was back in the day, they still is acting that. Well, he desert me, Your Honor. What you mean he desert you? It's clothes there. It's toothbrush there. You still doing the laundry? Mm-hmm. He living there. Anyway, so I don't know how you determine that, right? And probably this is why this is such a gray area, you know, in terms of when you have all of these factors or multiple factors, which ones have preeminence over others? That's for the tax planners. Nationality. U.S. determined that a person nationality gives rise to tax liability. Now there's another one too. Nationality, right? Nationality. Okay, you know we just had the referendum, right? The Germans, you behave in the yeah, I could. I know. But that constitution section is 12. Yeah, I could give my nationality, but y'all can't, y'all be with Canada or something like that. Okay, but you know there are some countries where don't matter where you're born, you are national of that country.
Yeah.
So what happens when you have that confusing thing? Right? Let's say France has that constitutionally determined nationality. If my pa or ma is French, I's French.
Yeah.
But let's say my ma was French, but my pa, Bahamian, what's my nationality?
In France,
you're French. But you can't be where your nationality can't be where you reside.
You say in France, you're
parents. No, the Constitution say no matter where I am in the world,
yes.
I'm French.
Oh, okay, so you're French Bahamian. French Bahamian.
I can't be two nationalities.
Is the mother of a
Bahamian? The Bahamas considers you Bahamian and France
as a Bahamian male, I don't have to be married to what that P word is? Progenerate or whatever. Procreate. Yeah. I mean, so what am I? You see the confusion?
What
nationality? I had a situation like that where a senior person in the entity was trying to avoid the tax obligation on one of the clients, right? So, when they opened the account had a Latin American passport. So they were Latin America, from a Latin American country. And then they did the update. Guess what they submit? U.S. passport. So that created a problem. Because they got tax obligation. So, the big G is, I mean, I'm as poor as a fireman. I ain't going to jail nobody. I ain't going to jail nobody. And the only thing I like about the referendum, right? And I kind of saw that it failed. Because if I ever was found guilty of anything, I could tell them, I identify with the females, and I won't go to the female prison. I used to be like, what the fella name in the U.S. who Obama just saw? The military guy.
Who changes?
Wouldn't that be wonderful? You could choose. Who would want to choose? Guys.
I don't want to.
You got some nice looking prisoners, you know. You know that? You got some nice looking female prisoners. I just saying, if you guilty of a crime and you got to go to jail, you should choose. Yeah, you want a choice. You know what I mean? I won't go to prison with pretty dudes. I won't go pretty
so
good.
What
okay. I just said.
And you ain't acting like a female.
What you mean? How do females act?
No, when you get in the woman prison,
it's about gender identity.
Like
it's not about how I act. Anyhow, that's beside the point. Sorry, I digress. Residency of companies, place of incorporation, test, management, and control. So, place of incorporation, like how you have all these IBCs, they incorporate in the Bahamas. But is the control in the Bahamas? So, registered office here? Office of directors, management, mine and management here? Or at somewhere else? In most cases, mine and management somewhere else. So, if I was the foreign country, I could attack all them IBC then. That'd be good for the Bahamas. You know why? They need mine and management. You know how much work you all have? How much money you could charge? Yeah. Desperate times, desperate measures. It's like when you break down on the road, you're in Canada, you gotta pay $200 for that record account. You can pay that $200.
And
exactly. And they all don't change no flock. Or you ain't got no friend you could call, you know. Hey man. You ain't got no friend because you done just all to do it. And you break up in the nigga. Keep that friendship going. And you don't know when you're going to need him, man. He jumped to it. I just saying. Okay, management and control test. Manage and control and standard test. Place where central management control is. So central management, i.e. is it in the Bahamas? Registered office, like I say, mine management, blah, blah, blah. So that's the test. Then they can tell you about Australia, France, UK, all of that, 118. Go over to 119. Classical system. Under the classical system of tax collection, a company pays corporation tax on its profits and when the net profits distributed, blah, blah, blah. So, for example, Royal Bank of Canada, Scotia Bank, so on and so forth, right? They operate here. So, or Credit Suisse. Let me talk about Credit Suisse. Then they, what they call repatriate the income. Well, you all know they make money, right? Mm-hmm. Not creditors, but institutions make a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And they send it somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
You know that, right?
Yeah.
But we don't impose no tax on them.
Nope.
You know that? Mm-hmm. So let's just say Credit Suisse or First Caribbean, whatever, they want to repatriate $15 million. To the home country, and they may be subject to 35% tax. So roughly, that's about $5 million, right? And we ain't getting nothing. Why we don't hit them at one little 10%, man? You know, hit them at 10%, and then they have a little tax arrangement because they get taxed on tax, yeah. Then they don't pay that 35%. To Canada or Switzerland or whatever. would be benefit. You know? My pet peeve. Excuse the machine. My pet peeve. There's something you all have called 400 as a fund, right? Yeah, that one. How much did it pay? You can talk it because it is, though. $900. How much they used to pay? Okay. What that means is,
yes.
Why would the Why would Canada, the U.S., or Switzerland, or any of those countries agree to that double taxation to give the tax credit back to the Bahamas for the Bahamas to get 10%? Like, that's not in their interest because they get less tax revenue to do that. The Bahamas is a third world country. You could basically bully them and implement, like, the laws you want. The Bahamas don't have a, like, big say at the UN or OECD or IMF or any of that kind of stuff. So why would those countries do that?
That's a good point. And that's a good point we made. Our politicians, we believe we play with the big boys and our big boy fans. So,
that's what
they're making
money
here.
It's about negotiations.
But
so
why are they
operating?
Right, they're making money here.
No, the issue money. Is, the issue
that's
is,
because they would just leave at that point.
See, the issue is also their tax code. Now, prior to Trump, most countries did not take an isolationist approach other than like North Korea and stuff like that. Okay, and you also, that's in your best interest to have footprints in these other jurisdictions and so on because you want to export and stuff like that as well. Okay, so you may have in the tax code these things that allow you like to net your tax and different things. So it's not that they're doing it because there's some, what's the opposite of ambivalence? All these lawyers up to mind, any vocabulary. If they just write free. What's the opposite of ambivalence? Anyway, they have no real interest in us per se. It's self-interest, it's self-motivated. Okay? So for example, if the Bahamas wanted to export its products and services, it might make it more attractive for Bahamian entities to be welcomed elsewhere. Okay? And say, same reason why we as country give Bahama our limb concessions. So we can get, how much job? 5,000 jobs. Right? No, that's how much people apply. 5,000 jobs. We have just $3.8 billion project. We get 5,000 jobs, and the estimate was 100 how much million in VAT that we give away. Right. Now, that's my only. I only discuss this because it's for doctors. Okay, let me just say, no political inclination. I'm just trying to, reason it out, like why these things are made.
We got it.
All right? Okay. Because I was of another class.
We got
you. Well, me? Straight up. I a PLP. So anyway, but so 5,000 jobs. We give away all these concessions, everything. Land, all kinds of things. Land. Land. Prime land.
5,000 jobs.
Here's my question. Here's my question. No, but here's my question.
But in comparison to what they get.
Okay. You hide yourself. You all know them. You had yourself a VW Beetle. You all know them Beetles?
Yeah.
Nice man. Yeah. Even though they had no air conditioning. You had yourself a Beetle, right? The old one. Yeah, they nice cars. They get character.
With the trunk in the front.
Yeah.
You could ride around. All you gotta do is worry about your oil. Worry about your gas. Okay. So anyway, you had yourself a Volkswagen Beetle, right? Had four wheels. You want yourself Ferrari Cayenne. How much wheel it have?
Four.
Okay. What's the difference in cost?
Plenty.
Okay, so here's my question. Before Bahama, how much job was there on Cable Beach Strip? Okay. So what you get? You get a new job, eh? I mean, like your job renovated or something. You
get a
you get the same job, bellman, housekeeper, waiter. You get the same job. Anyway, that's just my simple on the street thinking, but maybe I'm wrong. So let's move on. Now I could switch out who in the job. I can make sure certain other people in the job. You know how you change tire? Still four tire, but you could change the tire. You could rotate. Aha. Okay, anyhow. So the imputation would be on page 120. The imputation system. Company pays corporate taxes on its taxable profits. Then when distributed, like I was saying, by way of dividend to shareholders, such dividend is paid gross, imputation. What they're really saying is two methods of doing it. You may not charge, you charge a corporate tax, right? Short and long, it says you charge a corporate tax, meaning the company pay. Or company pays, right? To use your proper English. Company pays, because I could hear it now, I'd be like Trump. Smith used to be in a class speaking all kind of broken English. News media. Fake.
Right.
But
his alternative
box. So imputation, so the difference between these two methods that they're gonna tell you is the company pays, and when you do the dividend to the shareholders, you don't pay. Then you get the next method where the company pays and you pay. Alright? That's what they basically tell you. Now you read and you determine which one is which. Good. Let's move on. 122. I going fast enough?
Uh-huh. Yeah,
we're the controlled foreign company, that's like IBC, right? Mm-hmm. Tax avoidance opportunities arise when income-producing assets are sheltered by an offshore company. Sheltered by the IBC, income-producing assets sheltered. So you have this income-producing, your passive income and blah, blah, blah. They can tell you all about that. What's passive income? Anybody?
Passive, that's
more
like when you're investing.
Okay.
So it's not like a stock fund where you're actually
the
same customer.
Okay. All right, everybody get that? So you could have an income-producing boyfriend and a passive boyfriend. I couldn't resist.
That's a good one.
The passive one, you ain't got to do nothing, right? I mean, anyhow. Sorry, I don't mean to confound your mind. I'm sorry. My apologies. Okay, so anti-tax avoidance provisions have been enacted in a number of onshore tax, blah, 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 so on and so forth. Like what they really telling you in that part right there, right? And you got to read it on your own. What it really telling you is, we can look through some things, yeah? So, you come present this thing, like, this what it is, this company, and there ain't no tax obligation and so on. And because we ain't trust you like that, we can start looking through some things. We could go another layer, another layer, another layer. Just like you do investigative things, you know? It ain't what it really is. Let's look a little deeper. You may have to ask the right questions. Like, I'm maturing you off, stuff like that. You know, dig down deeper, because you may not be getting what is really presented to you. And that's all they're really saying. And they're saying this is typical in places where you have sheltered assets, blah, blah, blah. Okay? We good? Good. 124. New disclosure requirements designed to identify tax evaders. That's a good one. Because they have new disclosure requirements to identify tax evaders, not tax avoiders, but tax evaders. So that's why customs do their new form and things like that. And then they just want to be receipt and everything. Like, and you need your receipt for different reasons. Anyway. Okay, so yeah, new requirements. So when beneficial owners keep their offshore earnings under the radar, by failing to disclose them on their tax returns in accordance with the domestic onshore disclosure requirements, they commit the criminal offense of tax evasion rather than lawfully avoiding tax. So when you're in the U.S. and you have income, for example, substantive income over that whatever the threshold is, $50,000 or whatever, you have the account balance in Credit Suisse, for example, and you getting, you have a portfolio management account and you earning, let's say, another $300,000 in capital gains and so on, and you fail to disclose that, that is tax evasion. Okay. Now, Credit Suisse responsibility is to make sure they get from you a W-8 or 9. Which one for the U.S. people?
Nine.
Make sure you get a W-9. Because if you don't get a W-9, Credit Suisse responsibility in the Bahamas is to withhold how much? Yep.
It's 30%.
30%.
Credit
impacts. Yeah. Now I know Credit Suisse ain't got a problem with that. A lot of these institutions making a lot of noise about this. Oh, so much work. That's foolishness. Here's my game. So that's foolishness. Because way back in 1985, creditors had to deal with 35% Swiss withholding tax. So their systems and everything had to be in place to deal with that. So you used to get what they call the Form A or whatever to mitigate that. That's simple. They make a lot of noise about these things. A pushback just to have a voice in the public. It's ridiculous. And it stalls everything. Have intelligent exchange, you know. And if your systems can't do them kind of things, you all pay for it. Oh, but regulators, you want to know that, you know. People that be flaming, you know. Just saying. Best central bank. Yeah, okay.
I don't work
right. Anyway, I know plenty of people central bank, you know. Just keep that in mind. U.S. anti-avoidance disclosure requirements under the QI rules and FATCA. This is the next thing. You'll read that on your own, but the QI thing. QI been around for how long? QI, QJ. Long time, right? We were even designated a QJ. Qualified jurisdiction. So if you already qualified jurisdiction, certain things in place. So what's the big deal with FATCA? Unless you ain't been doing what you're supposed to do as a QJ, and you ain't been doing what you're supposed to be doing as a qualified intermediary. So what's the big deal, in my view? Shouldn't be no big deal. And if you were complying with the laws that were implemented in 2000, it shouldn't be no big deal. Because there ain't no new requirements, you know. You should already know source of income, blah, 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 the domicile, national. You should already know all that kind of stuff for your client base. But if you don't, what you do is you call the extended service provider to come and do a review for you. And then we could come in, we do a review, we do a sample based on your client base, and then we'll tell you, based on the sample, it is clear that you have significant gaps. We may have to review the whole client base for you. Because you have people busy with other things. Just saying. Okay, page 125. Disclosure by the beneficial owner. Here we go. So, if you're a U.S. person, you need to provide a W-9. If you are not a U.S. person, the foreign person, you need a W-8. Now, what happens in many cases is the client-facing person is fairly saying, so you need to discourage them not to do that. Also, these forms are supposed to be signed and dated. Many times, I will tell you, they are not. Because all a client officer sees is a $20 million account. They don't want to upset the client, make it easy. They even ain't checking properly. All they want to know is transfer instructions and when the assets could hit their entity that they work for. Why? Because they get money off of that. Performance management, all that kind of stuff, so on and so forth. So they're very eager to get the assets on board, sometimes even before the client, which, by the way, they shouldn't do. The client should be on board twice or simultaneously, mm-hmm. meaning the account should be approved. Don't take the assets in and the account even ain't approved yet. That happens. Happens very often. 126. So U.S. persons need W-9, non-U.S. persons need W-8. So, to bring it practical, on a practical level, you should be asking ladies and gents, you a W-8 or you a W-9? Because you could be you could be roping yourself into a tax situation that you didn't plan for. So you got to look beyond now. Just that's a nice guy. You know what I mean? You have to look at the economics of relationships now. It's more than just how much he worth. Now, if you start with 10 and he get 1,000, then don't worry about that, because you benefit anyway. Even if you got to pay tax on that. But if you start out with 1,000 and he only get 50, you get a problem. He causing you to pay tax on stuff that you didn't intend to. So he's now more of a burden than help. I just saying, and vice versa, you know. Anyway, and that's true with foreign people, especially like Cuban people have dual, you know, citizenship and stuff. Latin American people, dual citizenship and so on. Anyway. All right, so private companies. Oh, let me apologize. I don't mean to offend anybody. If you have certain preferences, just saying. Most Bahamian men, we don't have that problem. We straight. We Bahamian. You may cheat, but not on doctors. Anyway, private companies owned by offshore trustees, a grant of trust. Notice, because a lot of people in the industry do not understand this, so just notice. A grant of trust is one that is revocable, or where the investment and depositive decisions are effectively controlled by the settlor. Now, what that really means is this. I, the settlor, decide I'm gonna give my assets over to Tamarel, okay, as trustee. But I, the law, or in the deed or in my letter of wishes, I reserve for myself the right to appoint the investment manager, the right to remove her, the right to determine how income or the corpus of the trust is distributed. I return all these rights. Essentially, I ain't really give her nothing. I just give her the hold. Okay? That's the grant of trust. A simple trust is a fixed interest trust where the trustee is required to distribute income to a da 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 da. So, kind of like a will. You still wait? Okay, all right. Kind of like a will. I gave her the stuff, and I say, but now you must give to Takari X percent of this or X value of this on an ongoing basis. That's fixed interest. As a beneficiary, he has a fixed interest, okay? Complex trust. That's easy. It is one or two. It's a new animal. So the most obvious example of a complex trust is discretionary trust in favor of class of beneficiary. So what I do is I give Tom Moran $1 million. And I said, you know what? I want to settle this trust and I want you to take care of the people around Fleon, children. You exercise your discretion, you do whatever you want. You know, that's it. Discretionary. I pass it on to her, her discretion. Now, I could have a little letter of vicious behind there to say how I want her to exercise that discretion, but she could ignore that. Right, that's a discretionary trust. So, my recommendation, my personal recommendation, do yourself a trust and not a will. Okay? Do yourself a trust and not a will. better for whoever you're trying to enrich at the end of the day. You ain't got to worry about paying no, you know, going to probate, paying nobody nothing, the government taking nothing. I mean, you want, forget who in power, but you want the Bahamian government to have a portion of what you ain't got for. They've been trying to take from you all their life. You dead now.
And they still
take from you. Do yourself a trust and you avoid probate. That's my personal recommendation, okay? Anyway, 128 open. Sorry, what happened? Take money out of your pocket. Boy, look here. Some people die wealthy, boy. I mind being a beneficiary under that. I live that up for them. They go hungry all their life looking at that bank account grow. I know someone that needed any. Daddy, he's a dead daddy, but Daniel, for you, get out, daddy. I can't wait for you to die. And he did die, and he was very wealthy. Yeah, very wealthy. Now he's living it up. Okay, page 132, 3.3. 132. I have 132 now. OECD. I mean, I gotta talk about everything, eh? Aha! Important stuff. Okay. 132. OECD Common Reporting Standards Automatic Multilateral IGA. They tell you about the IGA Intergovernment Agreement. You all should read about that already because that was all about in the news, in the papers. Farmers Financial Services Board sent stuff out, so on and so forth. And you need to know who the competent authority is. Who the competent authority is for these kinds of things? Okay. Competent authority is not your everyday regulator. Contrary to what I believe with the accreditation, the regulator knows who the registrants are and everything else. They go into an examinations and all of that. So they're in a better position to provide oversight, in my view. But the competent authority is really the Ministry of Financial Services. It's competent authority. So you do your little report, and they have been working primarily through the Insurance Commission. Okay? Insurance Commission tend to be the more knowledgeable persons from past experience, particularly the FACA reporting. So you have a problem, you call them, blah, 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 so on and so forth. But my view, probably the authority should have been the regulator reporting on a monthly basis or quarterly basis. Anyhow, yeah, all you're doing is filing a report. What's the big deal? It's anonymized and yeah, no client information. So get key them things, and when the people want them, go to the financial service, say, hey, ICB, SCB, Central Bank, could you provide for that? It might be, but anyhow. So, common reporting sound automatic. You know we have something called TIAs, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What the status is in your jurisdiction with common reporting standards? What the government say? They seek to do what? Have these bilateral arrangements, you know, like wholesale thing. So you got to go one for one, like that. So they have to do an agreement with, say, France, do an agreement with Brazil, like that. Okay? And I think they sent letters of intent to, I don't know how many, 30 some, I believe, maybe.
It's blackmail,
man. What? What's blackmail?
Well,
that blackmail strong arming,
sorry.
That ain't strong arming. If we went after our money, because we have infrastructure to build, schools to build, people to educate, health services to provide,
okay,
let's pick somebody. Pick someone who dead. Let's see. Who dead recently? Who might have been wealthy? Oh, Moscow.
Yeah, he dead.
Moscow. The daddy, he dead. And they talk about how he came as a carpenter and stuff like that. And he pretty much have this empire. Right? Yeah, you know the Moscow's who won the construction organization. Yeah, so let's pick Moscow. So let's say Moscow was avoiding his taxes. He won't let any building thing around him. What if he ain't been paying his property taxes? He's got to raise that question. Because he owns 20 buildings. His property tax bill should be huge. Okay? But what if he ain't been paying it, but it's money in Greece? And we have no agreement with Greece. So we don't know that he have his money. We know he owe taxes. But there's money in Greece and we ain't know how we can get to it. See? You want that. I want that money out of Greece. Because he has to have a huge property tax bill. Huge. As a matter of fact, I had 3 agents assigned just to him. No, it's worth it. Because he owns a lot of buildings. A lot of buildings. And the government rent from him too. So the government should make sure his property tax up to date. Just like when I go get my business. I'm not saying it isn't. When I go get my business license, I got to make sure my property tax is up to date, right? So before they rent from him, they should make sure his property tax is today. Good question. I need to talk to Simon. Good question. That just hit me. You know, who has owned a lot of property? Cavalera? Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that. Solomon? Not so. Yeah, Solomon, but he said a lot of stuff. Seminit. You don't pay on vacant land, but you know. Iowa homes. Because if you build a house and it ain't sold yet, you should be paying property tax. You know, maybe you should. I don't know. Do they calculate that? Did they go around and reevaluate the value of those things? I don't know. Just as questions. But anyway, that's why we need these things. We don't think that we have the same risk that they have, but we do. So they're strong arming us. We should just use that to do. And then you all who have money hide in Bank of America and stuff like that, which is against the law. You know, or have them trading accounts. Are you all making, you know, you all doing trading, paying by you all American Express card and stuff? Anyhow, so, page 133. So the OECD model tier, there's an OECD model tier. So when the revenue authority of one contracting state, say the U.S., wishes to obtain information in a bank or brokerage account, or the Bahamas wishes to get information out of Greece, we have these tiers, so we should have a tier with Greece, for example, okay? The local competent authority is required to review the request to make sure, blah, blah, blah. And part of the challenge, too, is we have multiple local competent authorities. I don't think the competent authority for the tier is Ministry of Financial Services. I believe it's the AG. You have to make the request to the AG. So I think for smoothness, it should be central. I don't think AG need to be involved in that kind of thing anyway. Focus on the legal things. It done in place, boom, pass it on to someone else, in my view. Because the attorneys, they have to do other things, like pursue corruption and stuff like that, under the Anti-Bribery Act. Just saying. Because I still trying to find where all the money going. It wasn't no leak. It wasn't no leak. You know? Now, I just one little pinhole in the bucket. Someone punch all kind of hole in that bucket. All right, so automatic exchange of information tiers. You all can read that on your own. Okay. 136. Let's see if anything here. Evolution of AML policies. Oh yeah, they can tell you about the Palermo thing and all that, which you should have already read already. By the way, you all see, y'all don't read the punch, eh? You all see 90 case being early Tuesday, eh?
This case on what?
The $80 million that we got to pay him, plus interest. Because you all take the mandate's pocket by, yeah. You're supposed to take it on the poker. I know, you just take it and pocket it. Anyway. Okay, so, yeah. I tell us, remember, the Scotiabank case. See, I hit that spot. Boom. Scotiabank case, remember? Yeah.
Oh, you told us to read.
You're supposed to look it up. And LB was saying she ain't know nothing but that. This was a Scotiabank case with regard to confidentiality. And when they was fined in Scotia, X amount of day by their, for their branch in Miami, that you pass information over. And I couldn't remember the name. Scotiabank Voices. It's the United States government? Okay. That was what, 1988? Okay. We were talking about precedent. Y'all need to remember these things, you know, y'all bring over the younger mind. It's for precedent, right? And then we went on to say, talk about also how entities should look at the terms and conditions and stuff like that, and so on and so forth. Remember that now? And then LB was arguing with me, and I said you should orientate the client properly and have them sign it. She must have been looking up, so she ain't come today. But you can say that because there ain't no more glass after today. Oh, but she might watch the day late. She might be online. Anyhow, all right. So anyhow, why did I come up to it? It's because we talk about what is tax evasion, tax avoidance, and then they cite this case, right? The decision of Lord Tomlin in IRC versus Westminster 1936. How far did that go? So what the lawyer is supposed to do, they supposed to know precedent-setting cases. So when they go before the courts, they could remind the justice about this precedent-setting case. So the justice ain't getting sidetracked by the fact that you come in this court in this short Skype. No, that happens. You know that, right? He busy worrying and upset that you come in this court in this short Skype, as opposed to focusing on the case. So you gotta remind him, Your Honor, Your Worship, whatever you want to call it. Like that case in the paper recently, where the justice tell the regulator, you kind of have the rights under Section 157. They go tell the people they need to cease and desist. Yes. You want to read them? That was in the business section. Securities Commission, I'd read them. I suspect, I could be wrong, that they present the judge with no precedent setting cases. Because there ain't no way the regulator cannot have a right under Section 157. Not a statute that's based on common law that's relevant in every other common law jurisdiction. You got to have some cases. So please guide the judge. It's a precedent-setting cases. I'm just saying, that's my observation. I was like, not possible. But anyway, I was making the point to say, with regard to tax and even compliance as a compliance person, while you may not be an attorney, you need to be a Bush lawyer. You need to understand some legal things. Because when you are making certain recommendations and you are challenged, you may need to say, well, based on this precedent-setting case, IRC versus Westminster, it's my recommendation, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So that's the point I'm really making. Not that you have to be what, how we normally refer to our attorneys, learn it. You only need to be learned. By learning, because you know they're brilliant. They have the same level of arrogance as accountants, you know, or economists. Ours worse? Lawyers worse? I'm only repeating what you say. I have plenty lawyer friends. They special. Now, doctors hard at it. Oh, they hard at it. Doctors hard at it. Accountants could be argumentative. Economists, dismissive. Yeah? Any other professions? Compliance people? Undecided. They ain't never gonna take no position. All right. Anyway, then they go on with tax evasion again. They kind of cover a lot of ground. Okay, 142. Okay, 142. So they're talking about Cayman Hill. So they're saying, firstly, while it is true there are no direct taxes imposed in the Cayman Islands, which is true, so they're like us, except they are territory to be independent. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. Stamp duty, same things we have. It is a criminal offense unlawfully to evade these taxes in the Cayman Islands. So it's a criminal offense for you not to pay your customs duties and stuff like that. You know that, right? It is a criminal offense. It's not just a mistake or oversight or trying to get by and over. Criminal offense. See, I find over nobody to get charged in the Bahamas with that yet. But it ain't too long now. Especially since you're starting to ask a bit of rock money going. It could be argued that tax evasion in its widest sense is therefore actually a crime in the Cayman Islands. So it could be argued too that then tax evasion is crime is in the Bahamas, because when you don't pay your property tax, you avoid paying it. Like, you know your house value $340,000. And you say it value $200,000. I think that's avoidance. Actually. Who think that's evasion? Why?
Because you know it value more.
Who say that?
Don't they go by the appraisal anyway?
Which appraisal?
Mom? What you mean?
See? They pull in the willow of your eyes, so they go on over there and they drive around. You know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
They drive around and they make cars and they play. They picture.
Mm-hmm.
And then they say, it worth this. No, that's what they do.
Yeah, they do.
I might even hire a high school student to do that.
That's true.
My thing is, I know they do it to somebody writing that stuff for 300%, right? And I'm like, no, you need to call back a lawyer. Tell them, ask them this question. We have a statute in the Bahamas, under BRIO, right? You know that, right? Just so you can't just go sell things like that on your own stuff. You need a license? You have licensed appraisers. So I don't need no bush appraiser driving around and say it's worth this. Show me the people who work in our ministry who have the qualification to come up with a professionally determined appraiser of my property. I'm just saying. You know what I mean? That long time, nothing against them, but they've been working in the department for 30 years. I ain't trust their eyeball assessment. That's wrong. They should be qualified just like me and you.
I agree.
And use a process to determine the market value of my property. I ain't care that the person built this new property, new thing on the side of me, and their own value at $400,000. Don't extrapolate that to mean mine is valued at $340,000. They got new tents. I never changed my cabinetry and my tile or nothing like that from my billet 20 years ago. So my value ain't their value. You see what I'm saying? But anyway, me, that'll be my argument. My argument. And I believe the Crown ain't exempted from that statute either. I think so. So that binds the Crown, so they can't just decide they can do whatever they want willy nilly.
The only problem with that is the assessments are normally low.
That's when people used to be incentivized. People used to be incentivized. You tell them. People used to tell them what they want the value to be.
That's true.
needs to be incentivized. As a matter of fact, new construction is not necessarily more valuable than old construction. Because again, new methods, new materials, cheaper, so on and so forth. They're just looking at how much revenue they can make. Like, put this there, and you got to challenge it, and you go through all the frustration of 12 months and 24 months arguing with them and stuff, and they stalling. That's frustrating the Bahamian taxpayer, man. Make it sensible and reasonable so I could pay my taxes or even make the best effort to pay it. Then you collect more money. But when you do that to my auntie, you know what happened? Trickle down effect. Ain't none of us seeking to pay now. Anyhow, that's just my point of view. Sorry, I guess I dragged them. But anyway, that was ducking the tax, right? So, yeah, it's a criminal offense. So it could be argued that tax evasion, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. If this is the case, then the evasion of foreign taxes would be a crime if that conduct had occurred in Gibeon. So what that is the kind of dual criminality test. So where you may not have it's about the predicate offense. So you can say we have the tax in the Bahamas. So tax evasion ain't a crime in the Bahamas, right? So if you evade your tax in France, that's their problem. But what this is arguing is because they evaded taxes there, and because you could be brought before the courts for not paying your VAT and not paying your property tax and so on, then it is also, so the issue is, what is the definition? And maybe, I don't know, maybe we don't have that defined in our legislation because it's always presumed that we have no tax and da 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 da, which is really a lie. We have indirect taxation. It's a tax. When you get your national insurance deduction, what that is? That's a gift.
Thank
you. When you pay your VAT, what that is? Okay. Because you ain't choosing to pay. That's imputed by the government. Anyway, but I don't know. Maybe we need to have that debated in the House. I could give that one to Rollins. Okay, they talking about Swiss AML thing. Okay, yes. Page 146. 146, we are very near the end. Those of you who like Fiona's Cassad singing it as well. We're very near the end. CDD requirements under AML legislation. So, when you think about this, because you know you talk about CDD requirements all the time, so just think CDD requirements as regard tax evasion and stuff like that, okay? So when carrying out risk-based CDD, so for example, if I work for an entity where I have a lot of US clients or European clients, then my risk considerations might be, okay, what is the potential for there to be a tax burden or a tax obligation, or what's my exposure as an institution if I fail to do that? Like UBS, right? Where they arrest the guy responsible for the offshore client base, and he was going through Miami. But they didn't arrest him, they detained him. They hold him for a little bit. And then all of a sudden, the Swiss release all that information, remember that?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So we can do that, we can just hold somebody. Then they release information. So we need to find someone who works for one of them big Greek banks. Hold them. And see what information we can find about people who may have accounts in Greece. We used to think it used to be Guernsey or Jersey, but maybe it isn't. Maybe it's Greece. We could check that. Foreign Affairs could know in terms of where people traveling to, where Bahamians traveling to most. You see, we can assess that. But that's called cooperation, eh? Wonder where the politicians have their money. Mm-hmm. Anyhow. Panama papers got some people scared, you know. Okay. All right, so anyway, so... when carrying out risk-based CDD, how far if at all, should an offshore private bank trustee service provider that investigate the foreign tax affairs of its clients. So most banks, they just tell you, give me the W-8 or W-9, and that's it. Now, there's another thing, I don't know if they say it in here, but in this particular section, but it is in the material where they recommend, and this is standard operating procedure. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's it. So let me just jump down there in the middle of the page. In a nutshell, therefore, the requirement to perform CDD to determine that a settler client tax affairs are in order where such requirements exist at the size of a fairly superficial KYC. That is, unless a specific tax treaty exists, da 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 da. What they're really telling you to is, look, and you jump back up, service provider, well advised in these circumstances to require legal opinion. So the institution normally tells you, yeah, okay, fine. You know what? Give me a legal opinion or a tax opinion from your accountant. And then you get a copy, put it on file. So what that really mean is, yeah, y'all on your own, I get this. This is my security blanket. Your people say everything good. And then they always tell you, we can't give you no legal advice. So when the client come and ask you certain questions, institutions say, we're not in a position to provide legal or tax advice. That's a normal retort. And then we recommend you consult your tax attorney in the jurisdiction where your assets are, so on and so forth. Did anyone recommend, you know, H&J or Graham Thompson, so on? Tell you there are a number of law firms in the Bahamas, and they send you to the BFC, FB website.
I send them to the phone book.
Yeah, for the phone book. Yeah. They don't do that. Don't do that. Send them to me. Let me send them to the phone book. I could put a little charge in there. Yeah. I could even give them names in the first place. Contact this one. You know, I give them three. You know, I give them three in order, most expensive, most competent, most capable. Like that's how you rate them. I make money for that. Help a brother eat, man. So anyhow. So, the answer is extremely difficult to find from any official source. It is remarkable that there is a lack of specific guidance from both onshore and offshore regulators. For instance, there is no meaningful mention of the issue of foreign tax evasion by the Joint Monetary JML SLAG, whatever. So, what they're really saying is, all of us, including the people in the UK, we ain't taking that on. We can leave that out there, kind of grayish, shady, whatever. We ain't trying to solve that. That's your problem, technically. You say they're your citizens, they're your taxes, you need to do what you need to do to get what you're supposed to get. Right? I mean, that's like getting other people's business. You stay in your own lane, don't worry. You just make sure you ain't jumping over in their lane. Stay in your lane. Okay, so now whenever potential criminal liabilities imposed upon service providers, banks, trust companies, financial corporate service providers, you could have liability, potential liability imposed on you, and that's why you should do these things. Get the opinion, so show that you did what a prudent person would do. Okay, make sure you get the client, KYC, you know, you just take the client on in check. You know, you made the best effort, and when the client ain't cooperating, you manage them away. That's what you should do. So it becomes a problem. Only time you should have this problem is if you didn't do what you're supposed to do, like we used to say in the back in the day, in the first beginning. Because if you KYC the client and did everything, right? You don't have to be running behind them for nothing. Mm-hmm. Unless because of what information you got or something developed within the relationship, you asking for more information or you search. Okay? Like you married a valet, right? And then after you had a little suspicion, you decide you go in and register and check some things. See how much people he's eyeing for. Because he tell you he had no jury. He tell you whatever you needed to hear to commence that relationship. People do that in financial services as well. They give you what you need to be comfortable to commence that relationship. And only after you done commence the relationship, some may add enough here. And then you discover, oh, it ain't what he or she says it is. Okay? So, anyway, we're on the imposition of, yeah, okay. So, there exists a defense and or positive duty to disclose knowledge, especially in relation to the provenance of those funds, that the duties imposed upon and complied with by the this English people, man. This duty is imposed upon AML legislation and is completely independent of the duty disclosed imposed by FACA. Da, da. So what they're trying to say is your FTRE, your, you know, where you're supposed to do the money laundering thing. Yeah. That duty is kind of local and imposed upon you. Have nothing to do with FACA now. That's a secondary thing. But be careful. Because remember, FATCA and those have extraterritorial, except Trump may change that, but have extraterritorial reach. Okay. But once you satisfy your FTRA, you should be okay. You gotta worry about nothing. So people just be all up in arms for CRS and all this and all. My personal opinion, once you satisfy your FTRA, you got nothing to be all worked up about. I mean, don't tell y'all. I want them wake up. It's like some mom and you make sure, the first thing you do, I gotta go to the doctor. Yeah. That's why a doctor office be crowded on Friday. People don't want to live through the weekend, but I'm saying they, I just been to the doctor yesterday. I tell you, people don't want to live with anxiety. And not in a bad way, you know what I mean? Like they can have a persistent cough or something like that and they, you know. So anyway, what I was saying. Yeah, once you do FTRA, and you're happy with that, you kind of safe, right? But don't tell your employer that. Let them get wake up. And, you know, it's like going to the clinic and going to the doctor. I want them to come to the doctor because I can charge premium. I ain't doing nothing on the NHI. I can charge my $300 hour, is it? As opposed to the $30 to go to the clinic. So let them come to me because they nervous and scared and all that kind of stuff. They ain't care what they pay. All right, 4.5.4, CDD under the OEC Common Reporting Standards, right? So the obligation imposed upon FFIs. What are FFIs? All right. Gee, somebody read. Under the OECD Common Reporting Standard is to identify persons who hold, substantially own, or effectively control investments, holding accounts, and ascertain where they reside for tax purposes. Now, this is an interesting one. Interesting one. Perhaps it's a gap that many institutions didn't consider. So, let me pick on Credit Suisse. So Credit Suisse has a portfolio managed account for their ultra high net worth client, you know, the ones that have access back in the day for $10 billion. I say $10 billion. And their portfolio is externally managed. They have a mandate with an external portfolio manager, not within the Credit Suisse group. Where the external portfolio manager is?
In the Bahamas?
No, might not be in the Bahamas. Might be in the jurisdiction where that could be a risk and it could attract certain tax. Many people don't think about that. Because they have control over the assets. You got the KYC them do. Maybe you think about that. As a matter of fact, I guarantee you, almost all don't. But that's why it's always good. I say this with all sincerity, this is not a promotion. But that's why it's always good to have external eyes. Okay? External eyes. Because when you look at something for too long, or you become over familiar, you don't see things. Okay. Like I could walk into a store and I could point out different things. I could say, you know, your glass ain't clean. Same thing, someone come in your house and your mommy come in the house, right? And she started noticing all kinds of things, but you didn't notice it. New set of eyes. Or I meet Tom Riley, other half, right? And I noticed some things that she didn't notice. And she really looking at him with googly eyes, you know what I mean? something ain't right. My radar going off. I got a niece like that. She got a radar going off. But the point is, external eyes are always good. The external eyes, if it's done in the right way, it doesn't come in a judgmental way, but comes in a collaborative way. Okay, it isn't seeking to take the aha, gotcha. Like I could walk in Scotia, right? To pick on Scotia. It's just my observation. For example, the White Scotia branch, what for it?
Easy, buddy.
What for it? Voice. You know why? Because I could go Bay Street, and I see the renovations in Bay Street, and I see how nice it is. I could go Gable Beach. Right? They like 1981. When I was working in Barclays, offices in Thomas More, and we had all the cabinet, and you walk in there, you want me to tell you what I just noticed? Right? I'm picking on them, right? But that's just for example. When I walk in there, what I see is the cabinets. All them inspecting stickers all over the thing. They look nasty, man. Then I go in there around Christmas time and they don't give me little donut torn for something. You know, the service is good, you know what I mean? But it look little shabby. Shabby, man. So, that's externalized. And when you become a critical person, you do that everywhere you go. Okay? Everywhere you go. Whether it's a clothing store, shoe store, whatever, so that's what you do. I do it with Starbucks. And they know when I say something, they can fix it, see? Like one time I've been there, they ain't had no toilet seat cover for four weeks. 4 weeks. How you do that? Anyway. So that's my pitch for externalized. I want to spend a week in the AG office. I come to AG office for a week, tell them what they're doing wrong. Okay. Conclusion. Individual.
Come on.
The thing don't start at
11. Yeah, but you said 10.
11. No, I mean the Greek festival. No. I think it's 11 and 10.
Yeah, but last week you said 10. I was kind of about.
I say hour and a half. One thing now, when you're over my age, you get good memory. Individuals, high net worth, engage the services of private banking institution, asset manager, Now, for instance, to create and implement an estate plan, protect reserves, all these services they tell you they do, Another driver of the vast ocean for financial energy, both for individuals, high net worth, is tax avoidance. So, no. Please, no. People with money don't like to spend money. So the people who you see out there splurging, trust me,
they ain't got no money.
Then what you got? Farrah Gamo thing?
Mm-hmm.
They get the shoe, the bag, the belt.
Yeah, they gross.
They ain't got no money. Okay, they ain't got no money. One of the wealthiest fellas I know, when I used to work with creditors, come in there. He's one of the wealthiest clients they have. You know the young man, anyway?
Yes.
No, you know where the straw mattress is, the straw box? You know them big one they put over your shoulder and then? Them big one. He come with there, some shorts, some t-shirts, and that. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
The wealthiest client?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
That's
the truth. German guy. And I think they should tell you back in the day, but they want to speak with them now. Yeah. Like, after he had that one meeting with me, incident meeting, he didn't want to see that.
We have officer.
No more. He won't see me. I ain't gonna increase the salary for that. Or how they did, what his name? Spielberg. How about it? Woman, tell him, well, I know that you could afford this.
Oh my God.
Because they don't check like that. I know someone, I know that these places, when you go to his house, you know what you get coffee at? You think you get like the fine china and things like that.
Same paper.
Nope. Regular nope. Nope. Nope.
Coconut.
You know Christmas time. You know Christmas time. And you'll get them FedEx mug and DHL mug.
Yeah.
For
yeah.
Text.
Yeah.
Y'all switch between y'all coffee. This is real story. Seriously. You don't waste the end of that. People who get money will spend money. So the fellow who... No, the chick who come with all this, and she driving the new BMW, because you know that's the new chick car, right? The BMW. Yeah. Sorry, I used to do what I used to notice these things. You all know that, right? BMW is new chick car.
What car?
Chick. Females like BMW. Professional females, they all want BMW.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I want an SUV.
Yes. They come in SUV too.
I don't want
that. Anyway, that's my point. That's my point. If it's me, I go for the one who
don't have the Civic.
No. She have the store and go, even though ain't nobody in it. She driving the store and go. Ain't full of no trend, but she driving the store and go. We can wake on that. Because I know that one, she could be frugal, she could be reasonable,
mm-hmm.
You know, she ain't gonna talk to me and stress me out,
mm-hmm.
Or nothing, you know. She just gotta look good, keep herself good now, don't come shabby, don't come frumpy.
You are sexy.
Oh, you are, all they hear these things, alright, don't frumpy, you know what I mean? No, you ain't gotta be. You ain't gotta be. You just need to be together. Okay?
So,
and then, and this ain't chauvinistic. Show me you could cook and clean.
Show me you could cook and clean.
Hold on. Show me you could cook and clean. Trust me, I could cook, clean, iron, wash everything.
But show me, impress me.
My mom raised me right.
That's right.
I need a woman to be nothing but a woman.
Tell that, man.
Right? I can do everything myself.
Hallelujah.
I'm desperate. See what I'm saying?
Amen.
But I want someone who can help. Hey, set up, go into the, get your nails done, you're going to get your Mani Pedi every week and the hamper pile up like that. Trust me, you can be there by yourself.
You want soft feet or clean clothes? Which one?
Hold on. Paul Mullen. Right? Now keep your hands off. As a matter of fact, you don't have to worry about that. Because if you do things right, that man can jump into action, take care of all them things like that. I just saying.
That one free.
That one free? Well, you know how much he has experience that is? Happy wife?
Happy life.
Wait till man's heart is?
Wisdom.
All right. That's true. True advice. Anyway, so, when tax avoidance opportunities are exploited lawfully, like sending the stuff to Grand Bahama. my cousin wanted me to order it, they order it. They decide they wanted no more, and they send it to me.
Yeah.
I could try it with a whole car. Except they struck the guy with the VIN number. You can't bring it in. You can't even drive it on a Grand free board, right?
Mm-hmm.
The plate
count.
It depends on.
The board.
Okay. But you know. Let's do some things before things tighten up. Huh? No. So when tax avoidance opportunities are exploited lawfully, there can be considerable private financial benefits enjoyed by such individuals of high net worth and multinational corporation, albeit da 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 da. So look at IRC investment in case bubble. Now there's also something I don't recall if they talk about it, but like re-invoicing and stuff like that, right? So for example, I have a Bahamian company, but I also have a US company. And I use the US company to procure my goods. Certain nationalities operating clandestinely in the Bahamas does this, okay? I use the US company to procure all my goods. But because I don't want to pay the high customs duty, I re-invoice at a lower cost. And I have a loss in the US. Understand? And loss means tax credits. So, know this happened. So I re-invoice at a lower cost. So when it hits here, I pay a lower customs duty on it and lower VAT. Okay? And therefore, my profit margin in the Bahamas is higher. So I shift my profit to the Bahamas. This is why I think you should do income tax to get that VAT. So I make more profit here.
So which tax is that?
That's avoidance.
Really?
That's avoidance. In the Bahamas, it's avoidance. In the US, it ain't nothing. Just re-invoice it. You could decide to sell something at a loss. It's nothing stopping you from doing that. Just like I'm going to say it. You don't have to put a markup on it. Who mandates that you have to put a markup on it? You could decide you just want to make it a loss leader. That's legitimate business. Now, where it's moral or ethical is different than where it is legal. Because something could be legal, but be seen or perceived as immoral or unethical. You know, is it illegal for me to have four girlfriends? At the same time?
Yes, it is.
Is it illegal for me to have four girlfriends at the same time?
Mm-hmm.
Says who? It's not illegal. Is it ethical? Or is it perceived to be immoral? But I can afford girlfriends at the same time. So it mightn't be illegal, but is it moral or ethical? No, that's illegal. In the Bahamas, it's illegal. So those trustees that seek to have four wives as beneficial, I know of one that tried that. I had to reject one. Have four wives as beneficiaries, can't have one. You don't have Sharia law things, stuff like that. No. I don't think, if we made that, we probably should make that legal.
Lord.
The crime wouldn't go up. Your sister wives would get along quite well. Y'all don't go for that? Y'all wouldn't go for that? Y'all don't go for that? Well, how come y'all tolerate sweetheart and differently?
Just tolerate sweetheart.
Just check out the modern, check out the younger people on the dirty, see what they can do. Anyway, how many for the, what do you call it? Not polygamy, what do you call that? Anyway, pluralistic relationships, how many of you for that? No? How many for monogamy?
Yes.
That's plenty wicked, though. As a matter of fact, last finish, right? But let me just finish on this point. As a matter of fact, even if you have one wife, right? Even if you have one wife, you have one woman.
How so?
Good question. See?
Oh, he picked up the marker.
See, hold on. The modulation for men. Right?
Yes. He do something like that.
It's a wavy line.
That's the modulation for men.
Uh-huh.
The modulation, and you could Google this. The modulation for females.
Alright, there's a peak and then there's a...
So, it's a different person almost every day. No, Korean. No, you could Google that. Seriously. It's a different person almost every day. So men are like this, and women like this. So that's why, see, let me explain something. Right? Let me explain, you can disagree, but you Google it. Hold on. Let me explain something. Just allow me to explain from my worldview. Okay? How my God created you all. Okay? He created you all like that because he created us that way, and he know we can need something different and new every day. Can keep that
down. Something
all
be different and new every day.
They are anomalies. The regular guy modulated like that. For real. And guess what? And that's a good thing, you know, to have that new challenge every day. That's why he tell you the ways of a woman of past finding out. Never said about no man. There's a woman. You try to figure out a woman and see what happens. Do it. So you all agree?
Put your hand.
You don't agree? Hold on. The guys agree with me. Okay? Guys agree with me. Dig me. Who emotional? Yeah, okay. Thank you. The men agree with me. All right. Anyway, thank you very much for your attention. This is the last class. Good luck on your assignments and everything else.
Thank you for your time.
All right.